like, yeah.
Okay, so let's start. So at this point, you should be done with this, right? It's not. It's due today, so you're probably all done, just doing final checks. However, do you have any questions about stuff that was ambiguous? I realized one of the questions was ambiguously worded, where I was going for one sort of bit of information, but a valid answer, if you interpret it a different way, would be something else, and I'll grade both as correct. Another thing with safe assign, if you include like the question text, it'll show up as a match and you're plagiarizing. Like, I'm not going to ding you for that. You know, if it says you're plagiarizing, I'll actually go and look and make sure, like, oh yeah, your answers are the same. Then you get in trouble. If you copy the question, that's okay. When you're doing papers later, your references will probably match because someone else has used those references in the past. That's okay too. Right? That probably means you have them formatted correctly. what I care about is the stuff that you generate should not be plagiarized. Clearly. Any questions about that? Any questions about the midterm? Everything clear enough? Okay. And remember how late works. So, you know, if it's 8:01, right? At that point, you can just wait another 23 hours and then turn it in without further penalty, right? So 1 minute passed, penalty hits, and then it's continuous, and then penalty hits again. Okay, so you know, if you're working this at 1 a.m, go to bed, get up, finish it. Okay, you're still penalized, but no
what
more.
What is that penalty, by the way?
should be relevant. I think it's 10%, what the syllabus says, 10% per day. So yeah, so you could turn it in a week late and still get credit. Not a lot, but better than zero. Yeah.
When's it due exactly?
8 p.m. Eastern. Yeah, no, you know, driving changed time zones. Yeah, you could do that. Also, if Blackboard goes down, which sometimes does, don't freak out. Send me an email that has a thing and says, and then when Blackboard comes back up, put it on Blackboard. Okay. Any other questions about the midterm? It's going okay? Okay. That's a little alarming, but go on. And remember to write enough to answer the question, but don't go nuts. Right, if you're writing a 2-page answer, something goes wrong. Also, if you include lots of extraneous information that is wrong, I can't give you full credit. Right, so if you say, I don't know, how could the economic bias infect our interpretation of Cope's rule? You start saying about how the Earth is, you know, 15 billion years old, and, you know, and because of, you know, dinosaurs attacking humans today, and I can't give you credit, full credit, if you start including wrong information. Okay, so answer the question that's relevant, no more. Okay. Any questions? Okay, so today we're doing Darwin. So, why bothering with Darwin? Come on. And that's Monday morning. Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right, so kind of like the idea of modern evolution. Yep. Is that all he did?
He was a famous naturalist.
Yep, he was a famous naturalist. He wrote long books about barnacles and earthworms, study of emotions in humans and animals. So did, you know, a lot of active research in various areas. Okay, he had a theory of coral reefs that became, you know, just how Huggington helped coral reefs form. We'll get to that later. Okay, so he did lots of good science. Yeah, he's known primarily for, you know, that idea of natural selection. Okay. So this is a little short film you can watch. So Nova had a documentary about Darwin making the decision to publish. Right, so if you're going to publish something controversial, okay, I'll publish this, but then everyone will hate me. Except for maybe a few allies, right? And so it took him a long. So he had to think about whether he should publish or not. Okay, so here's Darwin, baby Darwin, like plants. Okay, old Darwin, cool.
then Action Hero Darwin.
So first was a question, and 2 points for any answer. I don't think you know this going in, but I wanted to sort of establish baseline expectations to surprise you later or confirm your knowledge later. Channel 41. One more minute. Okay. All right, and so we'll see if you're right. But you know, at least you know that no matter what their answer is, majority of you were wrong, right? I think you had more than 50%. So half of you were wrong, which is good. Makes you learn things. All right. So Darwin timeline. Okay. So here's we'll get to it. And I'm building suspense. One way people learn is actually by getting the wrong answer and then finding out, like, oh, wait, that was the wrong answer. And then that's how you learn things rather than, like, oh, yeah, I knew that already. You know, so that's what we're trying to do here. Yeah. Okay, so age 8, his mother died, right? He started working as an apprentice as a doctor with his father, okay? And then starts at med school, okay? So he was a pre-med, like many people here, right? Many people here was eventually a failed pre-med. Okay. He also began learning taxonomy early on from Judd Edmondson, who was a freed slave in Great Britain. As he started getting really into taxonomy, getting really into collecting. Well, he was always into collecting beetles and things like that. He started developing his actual taxonomic knowledge. Okay. Age 16, 18, Darwin starts flunking out of school. Does badly. Okay, so here, I mean, one of the greatest minds of the age, you know, couldn't pass med school. Now, two things hurt him here. One, you're going to see in the sight of blood. And two, this is pre-anesthesia medicine. Right? Anesthesia was about 20 years out from at this point, right? So medicine was not a fun business to be in. okay, so his father pulled him out of school. Okay, and so you're not doing well. I'll keep footing the bills for you, right? And then he goes to Christ College, Cambridge, for a bachelor's with a plan to become a clergyman. Right, because Britain at that time, you know, people, one thing people could do is just go off and be a clergyman, nice lifestyle, okay income, help people, still free time, right? Darwin started learning from John Henslow about botany, okay, where he becomes more and more deeply interested in natural history. so then begin learning, you know, geology from Adam Sedgwick, age 22. Okay, and at this point in geology, there is a big debate over the scale of the speed of changes. Right, so many geologists thought that all changes happened, you know, once from a giant flood. Basically, it's like a catastrophic school of thought, and then there's more and more evidence that actually stuff can be accumulating over long periods of time. Right, so river deltas form from slow deposition of things. This idea is becoming popular, and so Charles Lyell, who Darwin later knew, was one of the big advocates of this idea. Right, and so this is something in the air that Darwin's thinking about. So instead of having a short amount of time for things to change, now he's thinking about long time, right, and many small changes adding up to, you know, big effects. Okay, which of course relates to evolution. Right, lots of small changes relating to, you know, evolution of arms, things like that. Okay. So age 22, he graduates. So he's doing better now. You know, top 10 in this class, 178. Okay. And he plans to go on, you know, graduation trip to Tenerife. Okay. But this is 1800s, and his friend dies. Okay, and so they don't go. Okay, and one thing about is, you know, this is some guy who's like an undergrad, you know, your age or a little older, right? And historians of science are poring over everything he did at this point. Like, oh, who's his friend? Where'd he go? What did he write? Who was he dating? Right? And we have books about all this information. Okay, because what he did later. Okay. age 22, okay, he's invited to be a naturalist and captain's companion on a 2-year voyage to go survey South America. It turned into a 5-year voyage. Okay? So imagine if, you know, for grad school, you say, okay, bye mom and dad, leave, and then you're gone for 5 years. Occasional letters going back and forth on passing ships. Right? so it'll be isolation, you know, basically isolation for that time. Okay? Now, captain's companion, what is that? Okay? So it's probably worth thinking about, like, it's like a Doctor Who companion, right? So romantic interest, no. You know, just someone there to talk to, show things to. Someone not in command authority, right? Because the captain can't fraternize with the crew because they'd hang out with a buddy gentleman like Darwin. Okay? And that was Darwin's role there. Okay? Why did Fitzroy want a companion? Well, because he knew there's a history of depression and suicide in his family. His uncle killed himself. Later on, actually, Fitzroy killed himself. It's probably wise to take precautions. But having someone you could talk to on the voyage, that would help him. Okay. and Darwin also did, you know, a lot of naturalizing on his voyage. Okay. And so he had a 6-by-8-foot cabin. Okay. And so he goes around the world.
Right. So he's here, here, survey, go around. Islands, live in the world, back up to England.
Okay. Now, Darwin, so ships stay on water, right? So the ship is staying on water, Darwin took log ships on land. Okay. He was seasick a lot. He wasn't really good, so 5 years at sea is tough for the guy. And so he would go on land and take, you know, long trips. He'd work with gauchos in Argentina. and actually, he became, one of the things, reasons he became famous was his book on Voyage of the Beagle. Right? Has anyone read that? I haven't read that. But it's really cool. I mean, this is sort of, you know, action hero Darwin riding over the plains, you know, being shaken awake by earthquakes, you know, having armed guards go with him places. It's very actually entertaining travelogue. And you can see Darwin sort of thinking things through, like, oh, look, here are some very large fossils. That you know, now we only see small things of that kind nowadays here, but back then it used to be giant things that size. What happened? What changed? Why is this kind of bird over only here but not here? Okay. So you can see him making observations as he goes. Okay. any questions about that? Here's a short clip about Darwin and Galapagos.
On different islands, Galapagos life is taking a different course. As yet, Darwin was unaware of it. But as the beagle hopped from island to island, he took any opportunity to go ashore. On the island of Floriana, he was met on the beach at Post Office Bay by the governor of the first ever settlement in the Galapagos, an Englishman called Lawson. Lawson's tales of the strange Galapagos life encouraged Darwin to go deep into the interior of the islands. And wherever he went, he collected. They saw the tortoises, though only the domed shelled kind, so didn't see their secret. He saw the little birds with their different beaks, but didn't guess they were all finches. He called one a blackbird, another a wren.
We've got the finches.
There was another bird too, the mockingbird. He'd seen them in South America. But these were somehow different. For now, he had no idea how important that difference would be. As Darwin went further and further into the heart of the islands, he found a...
Okay. So, I mean, one thing to think about is, like, Darwin was still not really on board with evolution there. He's still thinking about things were as they always had been. Right? He's now starting to, you know, collect things and get developed questions. Right? Even, like, his collections of Geospiso, right? So it's important to know which island they came from. Well, he just wrote them down as came from Galapagos Islands. He didn't keep track of that. So he had to go to ship surgeon, who also liked shooting birds, kept better records of which island they came from. So later on he could figure out, oh yeah, that came from that island, that came from that island. Right? He was shocked when he brought them back. He had an ornithologist say, oh yeah, they're all one group. They're not, you know, distinct groups that you thought they were. So it was a little shock, surprised Darwin there. Okay. and collecting was a big deal. So all through his voyages, Darwin collected fossils, collected insects, collected birds, collected plants, and sent them back to England. And so by the time he got back to England, he was famous for doing his natural history collections, okay. For all the specimens he was bringing back. Okay. So this is someone who, you know, went out and found things, not necessarily someone who had great ideas about biology. Wallace tried to do the same sort of thing later, but ended up, you know, having his collection all burned. Shipwreck, ship fire, and things like that. So Wallace was similar to Darwin, but had worse luck. We'll get to Wallace later. Okay. and one thing a voyage across, you know, the world teaches you is variation in things across space. Like that mockingbird example. And why is variation? Why is noticing variation important? Foreshadowing. Where does variation come to become important later in biology? Genetic diversity, right? Yep, what are you going to say? Mm-hmm. Right, so the genetic diversity that we need for natural selection, right? You need to have something to select on, you know, some variation. Right? And if all you do is look at things in one area, it can be harder to see that variation. There still is variation. But you start noticing that as you go, you know, along the gradient, longitudinal the gradient, you start seeing that more and more. Right? It's the same thing in context. Okay? And so now we see, you know, we don't have this like single species of mockingbird. We have this, you know, slightly changing of space. Why does it change? Right? What causes this change? And so here's something that starts got me thinking. Okay, any questions about that? Again, Galapagos here. Okay. So again, the Beagle Voyage, 1831. Fitzroy gave him Volume 1 of Lyell's Principles of Geology, which is talking about, you know, slow change of the Earth. Right. Age 27, he ends the Beagle Voyage. Okay. And never again leaves Britain. Right. He was sickly for the rest of his life, too. And a big, you know, a popular hobby for people who like Darwin. So, you know, what did he have? Did he have Chagas disease? Did he have something? And so, we don't know what he had. Hypochondriac. But yeah, he spent, you know, 5 years traipsing all over the world and then just sort of stayed home. I'm not even going to London if he didn't have to. Okay. Age 20, started seriously thinking about evolution. Okay. So we have, so Darwin is really, he can start keeping notebooks. And so he just said, I'm thinking about this today. Okay, new notebook. And so we have a record of how his thinking changed through time from these notebooks. Okay. he married his cousin, first cousin, Emma Wedgwood. Have you heard of Wedgwood China? That's the family. So he picked well. So they could live quite comfortably after that. So he didn't have to go get a job. He didn't have to go after work. He just stay at home and do his thinking and writing and experimenting. Age 30, the book of the Beagle Voyages appears. Right? Popular bestseller. And again, he doesn't bring up evolution because they're quiet. I don't know what he sees there. Okay.
And then for the next 20 years or so,
he continues working to get evidence for evolution. So I was thinking about evolution, he didn't just say, okay, here's evolution, here's how it works. Here's how it works. He gathers tons of data.
letters to
animal breeders, letters to naturalists, letters to people who had a hobby of raising pigeons, right? Darwin has this vast network of informants to talk to. And we have lots of his correspondence preserved. Okay. he actually had a rearview mirror put on his house for two purposes. One, so he could see the mailman coming, so he'd be like, now, check mail. Yeah. At that point, it was like, check mail. If an emblem's coming. And also see if there are visitors coming, he can go hide. Okay. but yeah, he wrote people in Mexico, people all over the world about, their observations. Not really talking to them about evolution, but just sort of, why are these things where they are? Explain this behavior. Explain how you select for good cattle breeds. Explain how you can raise new pigeons. He took up pigeon breeding. It was an interesting way of generating these. Victorian pigeons were crazy. They had these huge poofs and huge tails and crazy morphology. But they took up pigeon fancying as a way of doing these experiments. Okay. 1847, age 39. Book on coral reefs published. Okay. And here's the problem. So, if you think about islands in the Pacific, right? Some are volcanic islands, some islands that have some fringing reefs right there, some have a barrier reef further out, and some are just atolls, right? Just the reef alone as a circle, nothing inside. Right? and so you could think, okay, well, they have one theory for how atolls form, one theory for how barrier reefs form, one theory for fringing reefs, and so forth. And Darwin's brilliance is that he connects them all together. Okay. And the idea is you have an island, right? Reefs grow only in certain water depths. Okay. At least the fringe reefs we see near the surface, right? Why might that be? Why might reefs need to be near, many corals need to be near the surface? Right, because of the zooanthellae, there's symbiotic algae with them, but they need sunlight. And not all corals like that, there's some deep water corals. But the corals that form the reefs around islands are that kind. They need to be near the surface. Right? And so Darwin's idea was that if you have land going down, right, then as the land subsides, corals have to go up and up and up and sides. And so you can get this ring growing inside. And if it lands all down, you still have this coral growing on the basis of old coral going up. Okay? And so depending on how much the land has shrunk, you could have a fringing reef with a barrier reef and gap, or the atoll. Okay? Now what happens if the land's going up? What do you see? Maybe, or you might just see like the reef just continues to appear, as it goes up. Things spread out, right? And so one part you can think of, if I have lots of fringing reefs, I could have either new reefs formed by others or others are going up, right? And so that's going further out. I have a lot of areas that are going down, so a lot of barrier reefs or atolls. And there's a figure, right? We can see, the ends we have lots of barrier reefs and bands we have lots of atolls, right? Why might that be? Mm-hmm. Right, so this is before Plague Tectonics, right? Remember our Alfred Wegener, you know, dead wizard? This is long before then, right? But this will let the Earth be moving and changing, right? And so what we actually find here is here, this substrate is going down, and here it's going up.
Because of now we know Plate Tectonics, right? But you know, this very, very simple idea that Darwin had of this gradual change explains so much here.
Right. So again, gradual change through time, leading to explaining lots of what we see outside. Okay. Now the crisis. Okay. So Darwin's working. Talking to a few trusted colleagues about his ideas, right? Doesn't want to go public yet. Why not? Right, so one thing is always getting evidence. And so those of you who are going on to grad school, you have the same issue where like you're working on some project, there's always some more bit of data you can get, right? So you keep working. Let's get that one more sequence, let's get that one more locality, right? It's very hard to say, oh, I'm done, right? And if you have an independent income and no advisor breathing down your neck, you keep working, getting big, better and better and better, but you never publish. But a bigger reason was also fear of public reaction. Right? So there are earlier books that sort of talk about evolutionary ideas without having a very good mechanism. They got very, very negative reactions. Right? It would not be popular in that time. Okay. So Wallace is sitting, swinging in a hammock with malaria, thinking about all the things he's seen in his travels, both in South America and in Oceania. So going to Australia, but various specific islands in the Indian Islands. And thought, that makes sense. So he figured out the mechanism for natural selection, right? Very, very simply, right? you have variation, you have differential survival, you have inheritance in some of this variation, boom, natural selection, right? So natural selection is a very simple idea, okay? So Wallace thought of it, he knew Darwin was sort of thinking in this sort of way, so he sent this letter to Darwin saying, hey, here's the idea I had. What do you think about it? Right? Now, what could be Darwin's problem with that be? Right now, I'm like, yes, someone else had the idea. This is how science works. Right. So he or she who publishes first gets the credit. Right, so there's just Nobel Prizes given out last week. Right, someone invented blue LEDs. Right, I could invent blue LEDs today. I'm going to get a Nobel Prize. Right, someone already invented them. Right, we also discover expansion of the universe. That's a cool big idea. The next person to figure that out, not as cool. Right, so priority matters in science. Okay, and so Darwin's working in secret, and this other guy comes and says, "Hey, I have this great idea." Right, and so Darwin knows that if he, forces his great idea to other people, then we'll also get credit for it, right? And then if Darwin sort of is like, oh, I didn't quite read this letter, and publishes his thing, then he's not being very, nice guy, right? and also at this point, his son was dying, right? So Darwin's a bit distracted. His son, died a few days later, right? So Darwin's having a very bad week, right? So what does he do? What would you do in that situation? Like Prisoner's Dilemma. Mother will take care of that for you. Yeah, we still have the letter, right? So, I mean, this happens with modern science too. So, I got an email from someone 2 weeks ago, who said, "Oh, I have this question for this project I'm working on." I said, "Oh, that's very interesting, but I have a student working on the same project." Right, and so I could worry about his students scooping mine or my students scooping his, or something like that. And we're collaborating,
Right, but also, you know, we can reply to each other within hours rather than months. Right, but I mean, that sort of scooping or things like that still happens today. Right, so that's what other people would, other people do. You publish Wallace's?
Yeah, I publish Wallace's.
Okay. Yep. Other people, what would you do? Pros co-publishing. Right? So you could write back to Wallace and say, hey, let's co-publish. Problem with that, at that point, it would take months to get to Wallace and months back. Right? Who knows? But then again, Darren's working this 20 years, just a few months. Right? What'd you do? Right. Yep. Talk to us. What else will people do?
You can maybe send it back to him and say you need to do some revisions and clear some suggestions while at the same time finishing the work and finishing.
Ooh.
Oh, wow.
That's been known to happen as well in modern science, right? So the whole principle of peer... So who knows what peer review is? Explain peer review. Yes. Right. So, right. Do you have to listen to her, his critique? So, I mean, the way it works is you send your article to a journal. So you've worked for 5 years or 20 years on this thing, right? You send it to your journal. The journal has an editor who sends it to an assistant editor who then looks at it and sees if it looks worth publishing the journal potentially. If they think it might, they send it out to people who are working the same sort of thing in the field. So basically your frenemies in the field, people who are like competing with you to get stuff out. They say, oh, what do you think of this work? Right? To be like, you know, having the new Star Trek script being sent to people who are working on a Star Wars movie. Yeah, what do you think of this guy's script? Right? You know? You think we should wait on it? You think we should not produce this movie or what? Right? And they give you comments about it, and they give critiques, and they can say, don't publish this, or publish this only after doing X, Y, and Z. And the editor then decides, yep, that's a valid critique, or you can ignore that critique. Sends it back to the authors, you know, to revise it, send it back in. Again, it might go out again and get bashed around, and then finally get in. It might actually get rejected, have to go to a new journal and start again. Right, so that's peer review. And so you could definitely do that with this, right? You could say, okay, it looks great, but you need to do, you know, talk to pigeon fanciers and some cattle breeders first, and then you can talk. Meanwhile, you can publish your thing. Right? Could be another option for Darwin. Any other ideas what you could do? Oh, by the way, the one thing about peer review. Why do we go through this rigmarole? Right? So it'd be just much nicer if I could just, like, okay, has my result, I'll put it on my blog, then I'll read it. Go ahead. But what's the rationale for that? Right. All right, it's been checked for, you know, that it makes sense based on by other scientists who are actually competent in the area, right? And if you've, you know, I say it's highly significant, P of 0.2. No, right? So they can check that, things like that. They can check, have we corrected for phylogeny correctly? Have we done good controls? Right? And so if it's passed this rigorous process, right, then it's probably worth looking at. Is it right? No, a lot of times it's probably not right. But it has at least gone through this basic stage of filtering and improving to meet potential critics. So that's why we go through this peer review thing. Even though it has this huge time delay, huge cost, so do it. Okay. All right, so any other thoughts what you could do in this case? LifeWorks being scooped by some punk. Into the crunch, right? So, you know, I'll respond to that letter in a week. Meanwhile, so. Right? So all these things could have been possible, right? And also, Darwin was connected at that point, right? Friends of the Royal Society, things like that, whereas Wallace was, you know, some poor collector off in the jungle. Right? So very easy to ignore. Okay. So what did Darwin do? Well, Darwin said, gave it to his friends, who were, you know, professional geologists and biologists, and said, okay, guys, I can't deal with this right now. What do you think we should do? I can't ignore this. Right? And so the solution they came up with was to read both Wallace's letter and a short modern summary of Darwin's stuff, and also an earlier letter he had written back in 1838, I think, about evolution. Right? And so they could see that both that Wallace got credit, but also that Darwin got some credit for priority, because I don't think it was 20 years. Right? what do you think Wallace would feel about this? What? Why? I don't think. Mm-hmm. Okay. So actually, yeah, so it's more loud. Wallace was completely happy with this. He was very happy to be associated with Darwin for this. Because Darwin's already a famous person for his other work on coral reefs and his collecting and things like that. So Wallace was actually very happy with it. Throughout his life, he was talked about it as Mr. Darwin's theory. It's sort of like if I wrote a letter to Neil deGrasse Tyson saying, hey, I just read you about black holes. And like, oh, well, I had that 10 years ago. But here, we'll talk about it together. Like, oh, wow. Neil deGrasse Tyson knows who I am. So it was like that. Right? Okay. And Darwin worked through his life to make sure Wallace got some credit and got, positions and things like that. So Darwin tried to work out for Wallace, too. Okay. But yeah, you can definitely imagine it going very badly for everyone involved. So, 1859, probably age 51, so that was the correct answer, 51. Darwin finally publishes The Origin of Species, which I should have brought the copy. It's like this, right? And he calls that an abstract of his theory, right? So he had written a much, much longer book that he had to compress to make it a few hundred page book, The Origin of Species, right? It even so, feels very long. But it was intended to sort of go to be popular and have lots of people read it, right? And it became a bestseller at multiple printings and printings and printings. Okay? And every time, he continued to revise it. And he'd put in, new evidence or, hedge on some of his theories a bit as new days came to light. Okay? Darwin kept working, right? Two books on insectivorous plants, human evolution. So he kept human evolution out of The Origin of Species because, it's living in the fire. Let's not get into that yet. But then he goes back to it later. Expression of emotions, orchids, and earthworms. One cool thing about Darwin is it wasn't just, about, promoting his theory all the time. Let's look at other things that interested him, right? So he noticed that, a ground he put in his lawn has sort of sunk into his lawn. Why did that work? Why did that happen? And actually, it was the overturning of the ground by earthworms, right? Earthworms eat the soil, worm casts. And so you've darn calculated how much of England is reworked by the worms, per day. orchids is very interesting. We have, lots of different evolution mechanisms for getting pollinated, right? Some attract bees through nectar and things like that. Some actually mimic female bees. And so male bee come trying to mate, and oh wait, you're not a bee, fly off, is already carrying the pollen to some other fake female bee. Okay. So getting very, very productive. Very productive. Okay. And then age 73, he dies, right? And he's buried in Westminster Abbey, 20 feet from Isaac Newton. So, a big honor to be buried in Westminster Abbey. Right. Well, let's tell you about Darwin's stature at that time. It's pretty high. Yeah, right. So, you don't get buried in Westminster Abbey just being, a guy who came up with some sort of crazy idea. Right? You definitely have to be a leader in your field to be buried there. And so, at this point, they have initial battles, but scientists have been on board with evolutionary theory. And scientists have been on board with evolutionary theory ever since, right? we fight about it, and we tweak different things about it. You know, what's the speed of change? Is it completely gradual? Is it, or does it start and stop? That sort of change. You know, Darwin didn't know about Mendel and genetics, right? Mendel's paper was written a while ago, but he wasn't actually started to be read until 1900. Okay. right, but I mean, so we still fight about evolutionary theory, but you know, among biologists, it's just accepted, right? And again, it'd be great if we could find holes in it, right? So for me, if I could find a way to disprove some aspect of evolution, some key concept of evolution, it'd be wonderful for me. I'd be famous, I could get competing job offers, I'd get a big raise. And that's how science works, right? People compete about ideas, and you have a new idea, and you support it, it helps you, right? People have been banging away at this for, you know, a long time now, and haven't really found many holes. So we can add, you know, there's again this shift we can do about speed and things like that. The basic idea is solid. Okay. So again, what's the summary of Origin of Species? Okay. Great book. every species is fertile enough if all offspring survive to reproduce, the population would grow. It's a fact, right? So we give this an example of elephants. You know, elephants reproduce very slowly, 22-month pregnancy. Even if they, you know, kept reproducing at their regular rate, so you can cover the elephants. Okay. It's like periodic fluctuations, populations remain roughly the same size. It's another observable fact. Right. Resources such as food are limited and are relatively stable over time. Fact. Okay. And I was inspired to think about evolution by reading Malthus, which is a book on economics. We wrote a book about economics, right, showing that human populations grow exponentially, but our food grows arithmetically, linearly. And so, I think Malthus is arguing that we'll always have war and famine and stuff like that due to overpopulation. Okay. And Darwin took those same ideas and brought it to the natural world. Okay. Thus, is a struggle for survival, right? The inference. Okay. Individuals in the population vary significantly from one another. Fact. Right? That's something you still have to observe. So, you know, if you look outside at robins, okay, I see a robin, see a robin, see a robin. You look carefully, you notice that, like, oh, they're different sizes. Oh, that one is redder, that one's paler. Right? And Darwin, you know, took that as, rather than being noise, it was important raw material. Which is a big step. Right? Much of the variation is heritable, fact. Right? And you show that by, like, you know, raising pigeons. If you have a pigeon has a funny shaped crest, its offspring will also have a funny shaped crest. And it doesn't require all variation to be heritable, just some. Okay? Individuals less suited to the environment, less likely to survive, less likely to reproduce. Those that are more suited are more likely to survive and reproduce. Okay? Now, no, it's more likely, less likely, not guaranteed. Right? So you could be the most fit organism ever, and then, you know, you're stuck till an earthquake. Okay? And just bad luck. Right? But over time, this sort of bias leads to this trend. Okay, selection. Okay, this slowly results in populations changing to adapt to their environments, and hopefully these variations accumulate over time to form new species. Okay, now the funny thing about Darwin is he talks about the origin of species. Okay, that's the title of the book. We don't really get into the origin of species, the branching of one to two. The more things about is how species change over time, right? And without specifying, you know, to talk about like allopatric speciation and things like that, right? But just talking about change through time. So they basically give us this sort of ecological speciation where things evolve to different optima, right? Then you get into the mechanism for speciation, per se. And that came with the modern synthesis later. Okay. And finally, here is, you know, a famous quote from the book. The last very end of the book. Okay. So for them to come to a continual bank clothed with many plants many kinds, with birds singing in bushes, right, flitting about and worms. you know,
So, I'll let you just read this. I feel like this is one of the cases where biology does not have physics envy, right? So, as you know, Earth is going around the sun, according to the law of gravity. But meanwhile, life is just exploding and taking off. Right? And also, it's still doing so. The problems have been and are being evolved. Right? It's not only something that's happened in the past, it's something that happens continually through time. Right? So you can go out today, it says, and look at evolution in action. which is a very uniformitarian view of the world. The processes that were happening are still happening. Right? Same process that causes a bit of grain of sand to trickle down the mountain, over a long period of time leads that mountain shrinking. Right? Same behavior of evolution. Okay. so it's a very, basic description of what his theory is, the rest of it is explaining what happened. Any questions about Darwin? Good luck on the midterm. Do you have any kind of questions? Yeah.
Number one about mosquitoes. Are you asking specifically if the mechanism of natural selection?